Hi, everyone. Welcome to our inclusive panel discussion. I'm Carol Hernandez. I am the Senior Instructional Designer at the Center for Excellence in Learning and Teaching. And our topic for discussion today is accessibility and the teaching practice. I am co-facilitating today with Jennifer Jaswal. She's an instructional designer here at CELT. And we'd like to give special thanks to Rose Tirada Esposito, the CELT director, and Elizabeth Newman, the vice provost for curriculum and undergraduate education, and all of our CELT teammates. And just wanted to highlight that March 13 to April 15 is Deaf History Month. So we always start our discussions by talking about why is CELT holding this kind of discussion? So we are focused on pedagogy and excellent pedagogy. We collaborate with instructors as they address teaching challenges. We see these discussions as a way to create a space for conversations that go across disciplines and throughout all departments at the university. We believe that inclusive teaching is excellent teaching, that those two ideas go together. So for today's session, we're asking, before you speak, please identify yourself first. And also, please, in the audience, please keep your camera off and use the chat to post questions. And now I will hand it over to my co-facilitator, Jennifer. Thanks.
Hi, everyone. This is Jennifer. And today, our panelists are Michelle Ballin, Professor and Associate Dean for Research at the School of Social Welfare at Stony Brook, and Professor of Family, Population, and Preventative Medicine. Our second presenter today is Glenn Dosh, Web Accessibility Officer, EIT Coordinator for the Office of Equity and Access at Stony Brook, and for the Office of Institutional Diversity and Equity. And our final presenter today is Patricia Dunn, from Professor of English at Stony Brook. And thank you so much for joining us today. And thank you all for also posting questions when you registered. To start off this discussion, the first question we wanted to ask was if the panelists would be able to talk a little bit about the social model of disability and how it can be applied to the classroom.
I'm happy to begin with this question. So the social model posits that the locus of disability, and I apologize, this is Michelle Ballin. I should first say that I am a 50-year-old woman with brown hair, blonde highlights, and I'm wearing a black and white splotchy looking shirt, but it is professional, I assure you of that. So if you think about the social model, it really does posit that the locus of disability lies not in individual impairment, but rather in the physical, social, economic, political, attitudinal, and cultural barriers that are erected by society. So we think of impairment instead as a condition of the body or mind, an attribute of an individual, and that it's not bodily, sensory, or intellectual impairment, but rather social discrimination and bias that in fact produce disability and exclude or disadvantage people with disabilities. So if we think about how to use the social model as a guide for professors in our classroom, the first thing I think of is the need for accessible course material that's presented in multiple formats, things like large print, audio recorded lectures, but also files for students to edit that can be put in fonts that are easiest for them to read. So I always include multiple formats of the same uploaded file for my students. When I assign my students, and as Jennifer mentioned, I'm a social work professor, we do a lot of role plays, a lot of recordings for video projects, and I put in my instructions that all students for any recording have to enable live transcription and closed caption, so that it helps our students who are hard of hearing, but also our students who are visual learners or English as second language learners. And I'll allow my colleagues to add their thoughts before I give some others.
So I'm Glenn Dausch, and like Michelle, I see the social model of disability as a design challenge. And since I look at things from an electronic accessibility perspective, that's really how I approach the social model. It's a lack of cohesion between the design of a product or service and a person's ability to interact with that content. And so my recommendation follows Michelle's recommendation that materials be uploaded in multiple formats, and that we ask not, is this material accessible for all of the class, but is there anyone who's the presentation of this material presents a barrier for, and then work our way to find a solution to work around that barrier. And Patty, I'll pass it over to you.
Oh, thank you, Glenn. Thanks. I'm Patricia Dunn. I think when I explain this to my students, I try to juxtapose ableism to a kind of a social model or critical disability studies model. In other words, ableism is the conscious or unconscious belief that that non-disabled people are quote unquote normal, I'm using scare quotes. And that if somebody has an impairment or disability, it's kind of their problem, you know, to solve. Whereas some forms of the social model, or what I'd like to think also is critical disability studies, turns the lens back on society, you know, as Michelle was talking about, and also Glenn, that society plays a role in exacerbating whatever impairment the individual happens to have. So this has implications for teaching, because we want to make our classrooms and our teaching materials as accessible as possible for as many people as possible. And of course, you know, we don't know what disabilities people have, but just going in ahead of time and doing some of what Michelle was talking about can go some distance in making things more accessible for everybody.
Thank you, Patricia. This is Carol, one of the co-facilitators, and I just wanted to jump in and maybe like pull back a little bit. So Patricia just said, you know, how as instructors, we're trying to make our materials, our content as accessible to as wide an audience as possible. And I wanted to just kind of pull back a little bit. And I wanted to name, you know, the interpreters that we have here today. We have Lisa Dennett and we have Blair Fell, and they are American Sign Language interpreters. And they are here to help us to make sure that all of our audience has access to what we're talking about. And I just wanted to pull back a little bit and maybe have each of you talk a little bit about maybe, you know, what you teach and, you know, how this is part of your teaching approach and why, and just a little bit of like the history of how you came to this point today.
Okay, so this is Michelle speaking, and I've worked with people with disabilities both in direct practice and education and research for the last 30 years. So I was introduced to this model, fortunately, very early on. And the way I look at it is all of our students are diverse learners. They're kinesthetic, they're visual, they're auditory, and the most that we can do to remove barriers in an ableist educational environment allows for all learners to flourish. So I look at what people with disabilities bring to the classroom as assets and strengths and try to meet where they're at. Thinking, for example, such as how do people ambulate and come into a classroom? I'm always ensuring that there are clear pathways for accessibility before my first class is ever taught. And I go into the classroom and ensure this for every class. The same way that we're here in this virtual environment and thinking about the social model, anytime I have a presenter, I'm doing audio and sound checks prior to the virtual classroom, because when anyone comes in broken, as frustrating as it is for everybody, this can really impact our students with disabilities who have processing disorders, and it causes increased anxiety and some other concerns.
So this is Glenn Dausch speaking. I approach this not necessarily from an education perspective, but in the typical classroom sense, but from the education perspective of I'm teaching everyone around me to make the world more accessible. And so one of the things that I look at is what are the small steps that we can take to make every interaction better? Leave the classroom more accessible today than it was yesterday, and continue to move that progress forward. And so one of the things that I often talk about is the fact that disability has multiple accesses. You can be temporarily disabled. You can have an acquired disability as you age. And so gaining that perspective is very important for both learners and educators. And it's one of the areas where I think we need to continue that conversation, because we don't know unless our students identify who our students are. And they may not choose to identify that they have a disability. We still have to make sure that the content that we're teaching is accessible to them. And Patty, I'll pass it over to you.
Thank you, Glenn. This is Patty. Well, first of all, I teach a lot of the students that I teach in the English department are going to be high school English teachers, grade 7 through 12, or they're going to be first year writing teachers over in the Department of Writing Rhetoric. So I try to get them to think about accessibility too. And one thing that Glenn kind of taught me along the way, and I try to do this when I can, is when I order materials, it's like to think ahead before your course even starts, and to try to think, if you're ordering a book, you know, is it available in an accessible format, not just print? If it's a novel, is it available as an audio? If you're doing videos, is it available in closed captioning? I've been rethinking how I do assessment, especially timed tests. Now, sometimes those are necessary, but if they're not absolutely necessary, is there another way to assess what students know? So that we're not just like, maybe somebody's not a great writer. And in English, we're always having students write their answers. Maybe they're not great writers, but they know the material. So is there a way that we can use different modalities in assessment to figure out what students know and what they still need to review? Because when you give writing exams, and I mean, I teach English, so we use a lot of writing, but if I'm testing their knowledge of Shakespeare, maybe I don't have to give them a written test. Maybe there's an oral test or an interview. And COVID has helped me rethink some of this too. And I try to have, I have pretty strong attendance policies and due dates policies, but I'm trying to be a little less draconian about attendance and due dates. Especially if I'm grading papers and I'm getting 50 papers in, I'm not gonna grade them all at once. Do they all have to come in on that day? You know, so I ask students, you know, if you need an extension, please ask, I'll give it to you when I can. So that, and attendance I'm still struggling with, but especially with COVID and all the problems students have had in the last 2 years, I'm trying to be more flexible and figure out ways to help them make up that time somehow if they have to be absent because of their own disability or just disability of somebody in their family. So I'm still kind of struggling with that. And I also, in addition to all the things that Michelle mentioned and Glenn, I try to organize information as carefully as I can and use clear language. And you know, my syllabi tend to be very long and they're not particularly attractive, but I try to be really clear and I go over it with them and I speak some of the sections and I have, anyway, I could go on, but a lot of this is planning ahead of time, how you're gonna order the materials, how you're gonna make your documents for the class. My students, I mean, I make them put an image in their papers and use alt text. And whenever I ask them, how many of you know what alt text is? In a class of 25, I might get one or two or zero who even know what it is. And these are future teachers. And I'm not blaming them. I'm just saying they don't know. So I put that right on the rubric and my list of criteria. In your paper, use an image. I don't care what the image is, really, but use alt text. And, you know, and I put that right so that everybody must do it. So everybody leaves the class knowing what it is. Whether they use it after my class, I don't know, but I hope so. So those are just a couple of things. So I have a couple of other suggestions, but I'll stop for now. Thanks.
This is Jennifer. And that's actually a good segue into our next question. What are three initial steps one might take towards making a class accessible for disability? And this is for people who are just getting started in this as an approach to their teaching and learning.
Well, I have actually way more than three, but I mean, the number one thing is to plan ahead. To think to what I just talked about, to plan ahead in terms of teaching materials. Some other things, I mean, this comes under, I'm calling it start with low tech common sense things. And this is kind of a little laundry list. So I won't elaborate on each one, but I like to post lecture notes right before class if I can, or certainly after class so that people can access them. Glenn taught me this too, or emphasized it, to use a microphone. If you're in a big room and somebody hands you a microphone, don't say, oh, I'll just use my teacher voice. You know, use the mic. And if students are participating, hand them the mic. And if you can't do that, you repeat their questions. I've spent my life asking students to speak up, and very often they just don't. So either give them the mic or have a couple of mics or repeat the question. Things like, you know, turning on the closed captioning videos, describing images and presentations, you know, rethinking assessment and how you're going to do it, making sure, as Michelle mentioned, there are clear paths for wheelchairs, recognizing, I once had a student who in the wintertime was always late for class using a scooter, but that's because, you know, he couldn't maneuver on the sidewalks because they were not quite clear. So anyway, those are just a couple of suggestions. I'll stop for now.
So this is Glenn, and I'll add to Patty's great list. You know, Patty talked earlier about being intentional about the materials that we choose and being strategic about how we organize our information, but it's also being strategic about how we determine what steps to take to make the content accessible. So the first thing I would say to do is look at your course materials. Is if you're showing videos, turn off the visual, turn the screen off, and listen to the dialogue. Are you missing any information that might be something you need to fill in elsewhere? If you are using images, don't just think about describing the image, but think about why you put that image there. What's the context for that image? And make sure that you're providing that in the lecture or elsewhere in the slide deck. And lastly, always be conscious of the color choices that you're using. If somebody is sitting in the back of the room, there might not be enough contrast for them to comprehend the images that you're showing, or even to read the text. And it's also important to recognize that we're not using color as the only means of identifying important information or conveying any information, because 1 in 12 men are colorblind. And so statistically, that means somebody in your class may not be able to perceive the information that you're conveying through the use of color. And
this is Michelle, and I will add to my colleague's very long list that leaves some little room for some additions, but I think it's about the way we teach and thinking about different mechanisms. And although some of us might like things on Zoom like polls, thinking that polls create test anxiety for some of our students and their responsiveness to this. I know Patty was very astute in starting with the beginning and the forethought that goes into the syllabus. I also would like to just point out that statements that we use in our language, in the way we present things, should be evaluated for ableist language throughout our syllabus. And oftentimes, if you have students with disabilities who you've taught in the past that you have good rapport with, I have a team of students. Now, please understand, I work on a research team with students with disabilities, and I run the Lens Center, where I have several trainees who are individuals with neurodivergence, but they have helped. And I ask for people with different disabilities to read through my syllabus and to give pointers to ableist language that I myself might have missed. And then when I think about the ending of a class, I have three questions that I can share with you that I always ask, which are, can you tell me what elements of the university, myself as faculty, or the students in our class prevented equal access to your learning? Are the difficulties you mentioned mainly due to the individual's inabilities to communicate with you, lack of attention to instructional methods? Are you experiencing any problems in our classroom because of the physical environment, or at the university, or because of attitudes of others? And I always include those for all of my students. There's no mention of disability in there, but through that, I'm able to best understand the barriers that have been inadvertently created in my classroom and try to rectify them for future classes.
This is Jen. As a quick follow-up question about polls causing anxiety, could you please explain a little bit more about that, how it can trigger the test anxiety?
Sure. A perfect example is last evening. We had a Lend lecture on cultural and linguistic competence, and we have a lot of self-advocates in our Lend program who are neurodivergent. And the presenter had used six polls, and we have a small group. There's 18 in that presentation. And the self-advocates, when we debrief later, were explaining to me how it really caused anxiety for them to have to do it and read quickly, right, and have a response, even though it's in the aggregate form. And that for one of ours who has test anxiety, that she felt very much put on the spot by having to answer these as if these poll questions were tests, because they did have correct and incorrect answers. And it was enlightening for me to hear this reflection, which I actually hadn't heard in this way before, and then to turn around and share it with the presenter and rethink our use of polls in this manner in the future.
And Michelle, this is Glenn. Just to follow up on your point, sometimes too, the quick-paced nature of rapid poll questions could be anxiety-producing for somebody that's not comfortable necessarily using the Zoom interface to fill out read the question, fill out the answer, and move on to the next question. So that can pose a technical challenge that may manifest in anxiety as well.
Thank you. This is Jen. And our third question is, how can we do better at accounting for and accommodating neurodiversity in our instruction? Neurodiversity is people who think in different fashions and can include ADD, ADHD, just as an example, but that is just the start of it. It includes many other types of issues as well.
This is Michelle, and I'm happy to start around this. So I think there are so many different ways that we can think about this, and also taking into account individuals with autism spectrum disorder. But I think the first thing we can do is think about ourselves as professors, that we're familiar with the information. We know it quite well, what we're sharing with our students. But for many of them, it's the first time that they're seeing this information. And to take a step back and remember how overwhelming that can be, especially when you're utilizing different aids and different mechanisms for learning. So oftentimes I find that my neurodiverse students create their own aids to help with timelines or different visualizations for our class. And when they do this, they often share it with me. And I'm often just so moved at how accessible they've made some of the information just for myself. And in sharing with them this, I ask then if we could use those aids to share with their non-disabled peers in the class to see if it would help them. And I think this builds rapport with our students, and it shows the added value that our students who are neurodiverse bring, and that we do see them as assets in all ways and not as a burden. And I do want to share with you a few things that I sat and talked with our LEN trainees as well as individuals who are neurodiverse about what they wanted you to hear in this question, because I see myself as just a liaison in many ways for this information. So if we were to ask our neurodiverse students what has made the classrooms that I teach in better, or where I've had barriers and then think about removing them, the things that they've shared are that it would be extremely helpful to always let students record their lectures, whether it's an accommodation or not. And that's because some of the lectures that we give are offered early in the morning, late in the evening, when people who might take medications are at different points in the process of their medication making it through their body, or just in their own ability to pay attention. And so being able to go back to that recording later is extremely helpful. Many of our neurodiverse students would love the opportunity to continue hybrid classes and the choice to still enter via Zoom, not just in person, so that when there are days that are more difficult for them, that we allow them this opportunity. To understand that our neurodivergent students have very different social characteristics and dispositions at times than you might. And too often, faculty neglect their questions and ask them to complete the task independently or don't value the questions that they've asked. And this can be very confusing to a student, especially who has built up the confidence to ask the question, to approach in the socially quote unquote appropriate manner, and then to have a response in such a way. So, to be open and flexible with our communication and to constantly assess our own biases related to social norms, not trying to target individuals with disabilities, especially autism spectrum disorder, the characteristics that define the disorder that may not be what we see as necessary for a classroom. So oftentimes when our students might be perceived as rude or jumping in too much, it's incumbent upon us to think about ways that we can still value communication and all forms of communication differently, and to allow people to take their time to communicate, not to finish their sentences for them. If our students are using alternative or augmentative communication devices, to allow them to process at their speed, and to recognize that all communication is equal. And I'll turn it over to my colleagues. Glenn, if you want to add a few.
Thanks. This is Glenn. And thanks, Michelle. You really made a lot of really great points, but there are a few that I want to follow up on. You know, earlier we spoke about not using color as the only means of representation. It doesn't mean that we can't use color or that we can't use imagery to represent information. But when we do so, to do so with text or other means of representation as well. And that's going to be equally as important for our neurodivergent students who may break down information, as Michelle said, using color or using icons to represent information that is particularly text heavy. The second part is making sure that we're presenting information in ways that students can reformat. So instead of throwing a book chapter length piece of writing at the students, if there's showing them that there's an outline that they can use to break down the chapter content or ways to move through the information in pieces to allow the students to really take in the information at their own pace. And the third piece that Michelle highlighted, but I think it bears repeating, is ultimately it's the student, the neurodivergent student, or any student with a disability who's going to provide you the most information on what is going to work best for their particular learning. And it's most important that you truly take in what they are saying about how they learn best. And allow them to really guide their path forward. And with that, I'll turn it over to you, Patty.
Thanks, Glenn. This is Patty. Glenn, I'm glad you mentioned that about students knowing what they need. That's why I always put on the syllabus, of course, the boilerplate that comes from the university. That all goes on together. But I put on page one, I always make sure I put this on the first page of my syllabus, a short statement. And I'll read it to you. And I make sure this goes on page one. Please let me know if there is anything I can do to help you better access the materials. In this course. Also, let me know if you can think of a better way to assess what you know about the course content. Let me know what will help you learn better. Let me know right away if something is inaccessible to you. We'll figure something out. And then I refer them to the university one. And I found that has been very helpful. I mean, there are so many different disabilities and impairments and different ways people learn. And I read this to them in class and I explain, you know, please, you know, I'm not trying to be nosy, but tell me what I can do to make things better for you. And this has actually resulted in people coming forward and telling me things. Like one time when I taught YA, young adult literature, one of the assignments was listen to an audiobook and we were gonna analyze, you know, what was it like to listen to the audiobook. Well, after we went over the syllabus and I had this statement, somebody came up to me afterwards and said, look, I'm hard of hearing. It's really hard for me to listen to an audiobook. I'm like, okay, then we'll do something else. You don't have to do that. Somebody else, after I did this, at the end of that class, everybody was still in the room, the person raised their hand and said, I just wanted you to know that sometimes I will, you know, make sounds in class or say things out loud. And I have Tourette's and just ignore me. You know, and this person said this in front of everybody. And I think that was, I think it was a direct result of the syllabus statement. And then another person said that she needed to sit, she told everybody this, I need to sit always on this side of the room because I'm deaf in this particular ear. So this little statement has actually helped me figure out how to, you know, alter the classroom or alter an assignment to better accommodate somebody. And I don't know whether they went through the accessibility office or not. I don't really care. I mean, that's another thing. What is it, Glenn? It's something like 2/3 of people with disabilities in college don't go through the disability office, something like that. I can't remember the exact statistics. So even if you don't have an accommodation letter, you know, from somebody in your class, you can be pretty sure that there's somebody in your class, probably more than one, who needs some sort of, you know, access, maybe not accommodation, but some sort of access. And I think that that statement has done a lot to help me, help me help students, I guess.
So if I could just add, this is Michelle, to that, because I think what my colleagues have just said is really important. I think it's important to understand that, especially neurodivergent students, they are not monoliths, and they need, for one student, transcripts, the next closed captioning, the next noise canceling headphones, the next screen readers, augmentative communication devices, sign language. There is a full range of needs. And just because somebody doesn't need that accommodation one time in class, I have students present with their needs being met 1 hour, one time in class. The next time they don't use an accommodation or they don't need one of their mechanisms for stress relief. And we have to be really flexible in their needs. You don't want to judge any of your students ever, but especially not on their worst or their best days. Their needs are fluid and they're constantly changing. And so to be open to those changes, I think, are really important, demonstrating how dynamic students and all students overall are.
This is Patty again. Thank you, Glenn, for posting that link in the chat to the statistics on who doesn't report. And I'm glad Michelle was talking about everybody, you know, having different needs on different days. And I want to bring up something that this is kind of a moot point now after COVID or after some of these Zoom sessions. But back in the old times, before COVID, you know, sometimes my colleagues and I in our department, we would have, let's call them discussions about whether students, you know, phones and devices should be allowed in class. Because, I mean, yes, they can be distracting for sure. If students are, you know, ordering things on Amazon or chatting with a friend, that can be distracting. On the other hand, some people really need them, either to take notes or certainly to access some of the materials. A lot of the stuff I use is online, but a lot of faculty are really hesitant to allow student devices in class. And I can understand why that's the case. And you know, somebody might say, well, if they have a disability, of course they can use it, if they have that accommodation. Yeah, but that outs them in a way that could be stigmatizing. So, you know, I always think, all right, if I allow phones and devices and computers in my laptops in my face-to-face class, yes, there are going to be students who take advantage of that, are going to zone out and do whatever they do that's not related to the class. That's on them. But I think most people don't do that. Most people use them, you know, because they might, as I think Michelle said this, some people need to record it. Some people need to, you know, to type. Some people might be taking notes in some sort of flow chart or some way that works for them. So I'm to the point where, you know what, you know, if this makes somebody's life easier and it doesn't directly interfere with the teaching of the class, I'm going to allow it. And I guess everybody has to make that decision for themselves, but I'm not so concerned about catching somebody who might be using it inappropriately or not paying attention. That's on them, they're adults. But, you know, I'm not going to disallow. And also same thing with, you know, having a drink of water or having an energy bar or some food or something like that, unless there's some health reasons why they can't have it in class. Because sometimes my classes are 3 hours long, you know, so, you know, things like breaks, you know, letting people have, you know, coffee or water. I hope there's no building managers here, but coffee or water or energy bar, or, you know, just saying, I always say up front, we're going to have a break halfway through for 10 minutes, you know, but if you need to leave, leave. And just trying to anticipate some things that might be stressful for everybody, really. anyway, I'll stop.
You know, Patty, this is Glenn. I'm really glad you brought up the you know, use of electronics in a classroom setting, because in full disclosure, I'm totally blind, and it's pretty obvious if I walk in a room, I've already disclosed. But in the instance where I would be asked to or be the only person using a laptop in a classroom, even though I've already disclosed by walking in that classroom, there's an added singling out that takes place if you're the only person that is allowed to use the device. It's not only just outing a student who may not have a visible disability, but you're adding an additional complexity for the students who have visible disabilities and who have to work around that policy. So, you know, think about the policies and what are the possible consequences of those policies before implementing them. That's a long way of saying, take some extra time before starting the class while you're designing it, so that you're designing an accessible experience.
Thank you. And on to our next question. If one has many course materials that aren't fully accessible, for example, PowerPoints, Word documents, or PDFs, is there a recommended order to prioritize?
This is Glenn. I'll start this one. The recommended order is going to really depend on what it is that is required for the class. Start with the required materials, and start in the order that you're going to use material. As Patty said earlier, you know, hopefully you're thinking about these things before you design the course, and you're designing accessible course materials. If you have to triage material in the middle of a course, it certainly makes it more difficult. And so you'd want to prioritize based on the importance of that content and the order that you're going to use it. With that said, you can go a long way using accessibility checking tools built into not only the learning management system, in our case it's either Blackboard or soon to be Brightspace, but using the accessibility checking tools that are available in Microsoft Office or Acrobat. And there's also a checklist that we have on our communications website that provides quick recommendations to go through and look at your documents to make sure that they're accessible. I'm going to drop that in the chat. And so doing those few things will really go a long way. But as Patty said earlier, the sooner that you do this, the better.
Yes, and if I could just add to that, you know, I said earlier that I teach my students who are pre-service teachers, I teach them how to do alt text. And I remind them about closed captioning and transcripts for audio, things like that. If you're teaching a class where the students are sharing materials, like I do, they, you know, they read each other's work, they respond and so on and so forth. If you teach them from the get-go to make their Word files or their slides accessible, then they're doing, and then they're sharing it with each other, they're helping you make the materials accessible. There was something else I was gonna say to that. Oh, I know. As far as audio, if they're making like a podcast or an audio file, Glenn taught me this, and there might be a better way to do this now, Glenn or anybody else, but if I'm making an audio, let's say I'm just recording on my phone for voice memo, right? Glenn told me you can use, you know, a Google Doc voice typing, and that captures the words and turns it into your oral words and turns it into print the same way it would on your cell phone. That was sort of a hack that works for me to get it's an imperfect transcript, but you can go back and tweak it. And there might be a better way to do that now. of making, if you're making a podcast or an audio, how to get it into print. So that's available. But anyway, if you teach your students to make their materials accessible and then they share them, they're already accessible. And I find that students are really, really open to this and really like, I mean, it's fun to make an alt text. It's easy. And then, you know, you can show them how to do it on Twitter and Facebook and I don't use Instagram, but anything else like that. They see right away the reason for it, and they seem to really like it and get into it.
This is Michelle, and I'll just add that similarly in teaching from the get-go for our students to be able to look at all of the barriers that are there that they didn't even recognize because they are doing these minimal extra steps from the early stages of creating accessible documents, then it also translates to our work in thinking about what external websites we're recommending that are not accessible. And in all ways, we're working with our students and preparing a class that removes many of those barriers. And I just want to add that while we're thinking about this priority order, and I think it's so important, I also think it's very important to realize that when you do get a SASE accommodation letter, and I know disability services are called different things in all of the SUNYs, that there is no prioritizing. There is fully accessible materials that need to be made for that student as an accommodation. So we need to keep that in mind. These are just steps as we plan elements of universal design.
Thanks, Jen. And thank you so much. We're on to our final question, and then we will open it up for anybody. Our last question is, what tools can I learn to use that will make my teaching materials more accessible to all?
This is Glenn. I'll start. So like I said earlier, Microsoft Office, Adobe Acrobat all have accessibility checking tools built in. Start there. Turn them on and run your documents through and pay attention to the suggestions. You can click on help and get more information. That's an excellent first step. I always like to start using the tools that are available and easy. So the most important tool is just changing your perspective. If it's, as I said earlier, a video that you're showing, listen to it with the video turned off. What information is missing? If you are showing images, take those images out. Does your text or your lecture content describe the content adequately? Those are the real low-tech solutions, and then you move on to using the tools that are built in to the software that we have available to us and build up from there.
And I would go back to some of the just low-tech common sense things like, you know, as I said, using a microphone, using big, you know, a big font on presentations, like what, 22, 24, I think is what's recommended on presentations. Making sure everyone speaking in a room can be heard. Doing access checks for presentations. Like instead of saying, and I think it was Margaret Price who taught me this. Instead of saying, can everybody hear me? And of course, the people who can hear you are going to, oh yes, they're going to nod their head. Instead of saying that, say, especially if it's a big room, if you can hear me in the back room, please, or in the back row, please raise your hand. That way, you know, and you might have to say it more than once, but that's better than can everybody hear me? Because the people who can hear you will just say yes. And, you know, if you can see the print on the slides, you know, and I don't know what to do about that, it might be too late, but maybe you can enlarge it. Things like that. And, you know, presenting information in more than one modality. I mean, I always, this is probably kind of boring for students, but I always read through the syllabus, or at least the important parts of it. And I I make sure it's available electronically, that it's accessible. Do a lot now with putting lecture notes up ahead of time. I also experimented with, this idea came from Lauren Cagle, having students on a rotating basis take notes in the class. And if it's a long, and then, you know, I'll just have them sign up for a day, divide it up. Maybe somebody takes notes for the first hour and a half of class and somebody else takes notes for the second half. And it's sort of a class participation grade, and they can take it any way they want. Bullet points, prose, comics, I don't care. They can take it any way they want. And then they sent it to me and then I would post it at Blackboard. And they would get, I didn't grade them, but I just checked it off when it came in. But that, you know, this was pre-COVID. So now we have recorded Zoom sessions for a lot of classes. But this was a way, if somebody wanted to review or missed something or was absent, that there was a way that they could review the class through my class notes. I also use class documents now, where I make a Google Doc. And anything I'm going to talk about, I kind of put it on the Google Doc and use it in class. And that's something that I've been teaching online, but I'm going to keep doing that in my face-to-face classes, find a way to project things and use Google Docs. Got to figure that out. But anyway, but simple things like making sure everybody can see and hear whatever, or in some alternate way, so that they can read it or they can listen to it, things like that. Just simple things to start with.
This is Michelle, and I'll just add quickly that going back to those basic tools, reading aloud all of your PowerPoint slides is a very simple way to make things accessible to your students. And I want to just go back to the basics, which is if you're choosing texts or you're doing role plays or case studies, to make sure that people with disabilities are represented correctly. And even by checking things like the Autistic Self-Advocacy Network, ASAN's website, and seeing what movies or books people with autism endorse as representations of themselves. And when you do this, you know, if you're choosing movies, choose movies where actors with disabilities actually play people with disabilities. These are the kind of things that I think start making access much easier to all of our students.
This is Patty again. Michelle, I'm really glad you said that because it reminded me, I mean, I teach English and literature a lot, and there's a lot of so-called classic literature that's got some pretty appalling representations of people with disabilities. You know, I'm thinking of Mice and Men, The Glass Menagerie, Richard III, A Christmas Carol, even To Kill a Mockingbird, Huckleberry. I could go on and on. And I think if we're reading those texts in class and we don't at least comment on the appalling representation, that's a disservice. And as Michelle said, we can pick texts where the disabled characters with disabilities are represented in a more progressive light, where they have agency, they have voice, they don't end up dead at the end or miraculously somehow cured. You know, fairy tales are the worst, right? In terms of disability being associated with evil or something like that. So I think in literature, in whatever texts we're using or films we're using, we don't have to throw out the texts that have bad representations, but I think they can be used as a teaching tool to say, what message does this character and the way this character is represented send about real people with disabilities in the real world? And students get it. They really do. They get it, but they kind of need that question. And I agree with Michelle that I think that those kinds of questions and those kinds of choices about the text we choose and how the characters are represented can go a long way to towards access in a general sense.
Thank you so much, everyone. We are getting to the end of time, so we are going to wrap it up. Just beforehand, I just also wanted to share, we have a link in the chat right now that was from CELT, which has access to all of the different accessibility resources that we have on campus. There are resources built into Blackboard, Zoom, VoiceThread, and the other technologies that we support on campus. And CELT is happy to answer any questions that you have about making your class more inclusive through the use of technology. I would also like to say a big thank you to all of our participants, the panelists, our interpreters today, the CELT members, and the wonderful members of the SBU faculty, students, staff, and administrators for their help and support in running these sessions. And we would just like to thank everybody for attending. If you have any questions or suggestions for future sessions, please email us. You can email myself or my colleague, Carol Hernandez, or you can email us at CELT, C-E-L-T, at stonybrook.edu. And we would be very happy to connect with you and speak on different issues about diversity and creating an inclusive campus at Stony Brook. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Okay, have a great day. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
I just stopped the recording.